Dr. S. G. V. Subramaniam is currently working as professor in the Environmental Studies Department of Anna University, Chennai. He has done 8 master's degrees including MBA, 6 postgraduate diplomas, a degree in law and doctor of philosophy in the field of environmental management and environmental law. He has done his postdoctoral work in France under the Indo-French Cultural Exchange Fellowship and at Germany under the DAAD Fellowship. He has been awarded UN Fellowship and done diploma in international lawmaking and diplomacy from the University of Joensuu, Finland. He is involved in several environmental impact assessment related consultancy works. He has guided several students for their master's degree program project works. To his credit, nearly 77 papers have been published and presented in various national and international conferences. He has been nominated by His Excellency Governor of Tamil Nadu as Senate member for 2 terms to the Tamil Nadu Dr. Ambedkar Law University. He has been nominated as expert member for the State Environmental Appraisal Committee for 2 terms by the Government of India. He has served as member board of studies in the Legal Studies Department of University of Madras. Right now, he has been nominated as member board of studies in the field of environmental studies in the Thiruvalluvar University. He has written several chapters in the leading books in the field of environmental law.
Welcome to the UGC lecture series. So we have seen in the part 1 about the environmental, Indian environmental legislations. Now as a continuation in the part 2, we will see the various rules under the different acts passed by the Indian Parliament. Indian environmental legislations. The first one in the 1974, after the Stockholm Declaration, the Indian government enacted a parliamentary legislation, namely the Water Prevention and Control Act 1974. After that, under the act, one more rules have also been passed in the year 1975, namely the Water Prevention and Control Pollution Rules 1975. Then we have got the Water Prevention and Control of Pollution Procedures for the Transaction of the Business. Then Water Prevention and Control of Pollution Cess Act 1977, and that has been amended in the year 1991 also. Then with reference to the year, again the Parliament in the year 1991 enacted a special legislation, namely the Air Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1981, and this has been amended in the year 1987 also. Then if you see what are the other environmental legislations means, in the year 1986, there is an Umbrella Act has been passed. An Umbrella Act means that Water Prevention and Control of Act means is with reference to only the water prevention and control, water pollution prevention and control. With reference to the air prevention and control of the pollution act. But Environmental Protection Act covers not only the air, water, anything and everything with reference to the environment. It is a comprehensive act. It is an umbrella act. It has been passed in the Parliament in the year 1986. Then after that, in the year 1991, another act has also been passed by our Parliament, namely the Public Liability Insurance Act. What is the Public Liability Insurance Act? If there is any accident inside the industry has to pay the compensation to their workers. But the effect of that accident is being felt outside the industry means there was no comprehensive legislation to compensate it, not only for the loss of the limbs and the life, but also for the ecosystem damage. Now the Public Liability Insurance Act covers for everything, including that accident, which including the loss which has occurred to the ecosystem, life and limb of the human being, and the cattle loss, crop lost, everything. For that, a special insurance has been created and every industry has to pay the insurance amount for that matter. This act is called Public Liability Insurance Act, which has been enacted by our Parliament in the year 1991. Next, with reference to that, there are a lot of disputes have to be happened between the industries, then between the industry and the government, then between the industry and the statutory body, namely the Pollution Control Board. If the matter is taken for, every matter is taken to the court, means the court will have its own procedure and it takes a very long time in for the disposal of the case. So for that, the government of India realized, and under the Tribunals Act, it has created a tribunal in continuation of like other tribunals, like Central Administrative Tribunal, then State Administrative Tribunal, Railway Rates Tribunal, Customs Tribunal, Central Excise Tribunal, Income Tax Tribunal. Like that, that Government of India has created National Green Tribunal for that. Under the, this tribunal has been created under a special act, namely the National Green Tribunal Act in the year 1995. What is after all a tribunal? A tribunal is nothing but an extension of the administrative body during the quasi-judicial function. Now, this tribunal at present functioning with four benches, north, south, east and west, then one more bench on the central, and above all the overall bench which is functioning at the Delhi. If there is any dispute with reference to that environment, means it has to be brought first to the notice of the tribunal. After the case has been duly disposed by the tribunal, if there is any appeal, then they have to appeal again to the tribunal. After that only it has to take, the matter has to be taken to the higher judiciary, namely the High Court or the Supreme Court. Now, the purpose of enacting the National Green Tribunal Act very clearly states that in order to get the speedy justice, in order to dispose the environment related cases at a speedy way. Then after that, National Environmental Appellate Authority has been created. With reference to that environmental impact assessment, any dispute arises between the industry and the Pollution Control Board, now they have to refer the matter only to the National Environment Appellate Authority. This appellate authority is an administrative body doing a quasi-judicial function. Now, this appellate authority is empowered to hear only the appeals. Then after the appeal has been disposed, then only you can go to the court. So, this act has been enacted with an eye in order to get a speedy justice, in order to dispose the environmental related cases at an early one. You have got the Forest Conservation Act 1980. Various rules under the brought under the Environmental Protection Act 1986. See, as far as the acts are concerned, we can say there are only major 6 acts are there. Apart from that, every time the parliament cannot go on enact the legislation, because enacting a legislation takes a long time. It is a very tedious one. Of course, as a students, everybody will be knowing it. You have to bring the first reading inside the Lok Sabha, then second reading, it has to pass the Rajya Sabha, then finally it has to get the assent from the President of India. But depending upon the urgency of the case, okay, you can brought ordinance. Again, that ordinance also has to pass in both the houses of the parliament. Realizing the importance of the environment, the government of India, even in the Environmental Protection Act itself, is given a sort of a blank check to the administrative body under the Section 5 of the EP Act to bring any rules, regulations, notifications like that. Now, again, these rules and regulations have to be once again ratified inside the parliament, of course. Now, with this Section 3 of the Environmental Protection Act, now the Ministry of Environment and Forest has brought more than 90 rules for that matter. If you just a cursory glance of the rules are the following. Emission standards of pollutants from the various industries, rules have been brought. After that, guidelines for the location of industries, mining operations, then environmental impact assessment for the development of the projects. Now, in this connection, I would like to state a few words about the environmental impact assessment. If any industry have to be started, means that the industry have to, in order to get the clearance from the statutory body, namely the Pollution Control Board, if the industry is of a major industry, it has to get the clearance from the Ministry of Environment and Forest at the central level. Now, one of the mandatory and one of the statutory requirement for the industry is to carry out an environmental impact assessment. What is that environmental impact assessment? Environmental impact assessment is nothing but by starting this industry, what impact it creates on the environment during the operation, during the construction phase, during the operation phase. During the construction phase, what impact it creates on the air, what impact it creates on the water, what impact, that is the, what is the bio, is there any biodiversity lost, how the forest land is going to be affected, like that you have to work it out during the construction phase. After that, during the operational phase, that is from the acquirence of the raw materials by getting that finished goods, during the process of the industries, what amount of the air pollution it creates, what amount of the water pollution it creates, and whether the suitable mitigation measures have been incorporated in the process in order to reduce the water pollution, air pollution and other type of the pollution, as well as what type of the treatment methodologies they have incorporated at the end pipe treatment, and finally the effluents have to be discharged within the prescribed standards of the pollution control board. Unless otherwise you submit a report and convince that state environmental assessment, impact assessment authorities, you cannot get the clearance from the respective pollution control board as well as the Ministry of Environment and Forest. For that purpose, they have created an environmental standards for that. This is what which is being given in the environmental impact assessment and development of the project rules for that matter. Then we have got the next rules, namely the hazardous waste management handling rules. What is that? Hazardous waste. Any industry, after the process, the finally certain waste which cannot be disposed of further. And these wastes are called, which cannot be disposed further, are hazardous not only to the human being but also to the system. Now, these hazardous waste have to be either stored or after the due storage, they have to be properly dumped at a site which has been chosen for that purpose. And in this hazardous waste management handling rules, it is very clearly enshrined and very clearly enlightened that what procedures have to be followed in order to dispose this hazardous waste properly without causing any damage to the environment. So, this is one of the major important rules which has been brought under the Environmental Protection Act 1986. Okay. The next one, we will see the management, storage, import of hazardous chemical rules. Then, it is needless to say that India, the 3/4 of our border is being covered by the sea. On one side, we are having the Arabian Sea. On the eastern side, we have got the Bay of Bengal. On the southern side, we have got the Indian Ocean. Nearly 3/4 of our land area are covered with the coastal zone. In order to maintain the coastal zone properly, we have brought a special notification, namely the Coastal Regulation Zone Notification in the year 1992 itself. After that, it has been amended several times. Now, the CRZ notification, namely the Coastal Regulation Zone Notification, classifies our coastal zone into four zones: Zone 1, Zone 2, Zone 3, and Zone 4 is exclusively for Andaman Nicobar Islands. Now, in this CRZ notification, it is very clearly said what distance you have to carry out the developmental activities, what type of the developmental activities or what type of the industries which you can run, and what are the various permitted and prohibited activities within that zone, it is very clearly mentioned. For example, that 500 meters from the highest of the high tide zone is considered to be the no development area. After that, another 200 meters. After that, another 200 meters. Like that, it has zoned the areas and from the land and only on the land side. Of course, the rules have been little bit relaxed with reference to the creek areas, with reference to the mangrove areas, with reference to the riverbed areas, like that. Now, CRZ notification clearly regulates our coastal areas for that. Now, in order to see whether these CRZ notifications have been effectively implemented both letter and spirit, again, a special authorities have been created, namely the Coastal Regulation Zone Authority for that matter. Then next one, we will see the scheme of labeling the environment friendly products. Then restricting certain activities range in special specified areas of Aravalli. Then the most important is the biomedical waste management and handling rules, which was brought in the year 1998. What is a biomedical waste? A waste which is created in any of the hospitals, clinics, which treats not only the human being but also the animals, then any of the laboratories or the nursing home, whatever the waste which has been created out of these activities is considered to be the biomedical waste. Now you cannot employ the same method what is being to how the wastes are being treated with reference to the solid waste or with reference to the hazardous waste. You cannot employ the same for the biomedical waste. These biomedical waste have got the special characteristics unless it is not like a municipal solid waste or the hazardous waste. Now these wastes are infectious in nature, and these waste cannot be treated like any other waste, and it cannot be put it in any of the public places for that matter. Now these wastes have been categorized into 8 categories: category 1, category 2, category 3, like that. Now these waste, according to the type of nature of the things, either they have to be incinerated, or they have to be deep buried, or they have to be sterilized for that matter. To quote only one example, for example, if there is any loss of limb, if there is any limb lost, or any of the body parts have been amputated, now these parts have to be either deeply buried or it has to be incinerated. What is that incineration? In the absence of oxygen, we have to burn it at 1200 degree centigrade for that matter. Then of course that non-biodegradable waste, like the syringes, like the tablet, that foils, these have to be incinerated. Now the biomedical waste management handling rules clearly classify what type of the waste, how the waste have to be disposed, what type of the technology it has to be followed. Then the next one, eco-sensitive dune notification in the year 1998. Then Environmental Protection Second Amendment rules, 2T oil regulation supply and distribution order in the year 1998, recycled plastic manufacture and usage rules in the year 1999, environmental sitting for industrial projects rules in the year 1999, Taj Trapezium Zone Prevention and Control Authority order, dumping and disposal of the fly ash notification. What is that fly ash? After the coal is burned for the purpose of production of the electricity, what is that is left over is the fly ash. Now the fly ash disposal is the biggest problem. Now this government of India has brought a special rule, these fly ash have to be mixed along with the cement, and it has to be used for the construction purpose for that matter. Then the various rules, continuation of that, noise pollution control and regulation rules. Noise pollution, hitherto the noise pollution was treated only as a nuisance. It was treated under the common law. What is a nuisance? It is very difficult to define what is a nuisance for that matter. Suppose you are residing in a flat. The neighbor is putting a big music or a jazz music, break dance, like that when you put and dances at 10 o'clock means, then you can say it is a nuisance which is created to me. But on the other hand, if the fellow argues, you are also putting in the morning at 4 o'clock or at 5 o'clock some divine music, then that is causing a nuisance to me. Like that, it is very difficult to define what is a nuisance. One man's nuisance may not be an another man's nuisance for that. In that case, we are, for example, in India, we are not following the common law. That is one aspect. Now, whatever that qualitatively described, now it has been quantitatively said under the noise pollution control rules, that noise is being measured in the form of decibels. And what areas, what is the quantum of the decibels, at what time it is allowed, it is clearly quantified. For example, these areas have been classified that this is an industrial area, this is a hospital area, this is an educational area, this is the residential area. Like that, it is clearly classified. Now, secondly, this has been classified. What is the daytime? This is the limitation of the noise. During the night time, this is the limitation for the noise. Like that, they have put what is the daytime and what is the night time. What is the daytime? From morning 6 o'clock to up to 9 o'clock in the night, it is the daytime. From 9 o'clock to the next day morning, it is the night time. Okay, now the time is also clearly specified, area also clearly specified. Apart from that, the noise which is being measured in decibels, they have very clearly said in the residential area, during the night time, during the daytime, this is the quantum of the noise that is allowed. Beyond that, it is considered as a noise pollution. Like that, for the different areas, they have put the different quantity of the decibels that is being allowed for that matter. So, this is what Noise Prevention and Control of Pollution Rules 1991. Then what type of the precautionary measures you have to take also very clearly specified, not only in the noise pollution control rules, but also even in the factory rules also for that matter. Then the most important, that is, this is the major problem in India, not only in the urban towns, even in the villages also, whatever the waste which is generated out of our household activities, namely the municipal solid waste for these municipal solid waste management and handling rules 1999 have been brought under the section 5 of the Environmental Protection Act. I have told you what is a municipal solid waste. To reinforce it, I will just say once again, whatever the waste which is generated out of household activities, and that solid waste is considered to be the municipal solid waste. Now, under the Municipal Solid Waste Management Handling Rules, it is clearly mentioned how the waste have to be segregated at the source. At the source, we can classify the waste into two. Number one, a biodegradable one. Number two, as a non-biodegradable. Then you can clearly state, these are all the waste which are considered to be the biodegradable. These are all the waste which are considered to be the non-biodegradable. So, at the source itself, you have to segregate the waste biodegradable and non-biodegradable. And one, you are putting it in the green bin, namely the biodegradable, non-biodegradable, you are putting it into the red bin. Now, how the waste have to be collected? After the due collection of the waste, how the waste has to be temporarily stored? After the storage of this one, how the waste have to be transported, what type of the transport they have to use it, everything is very clearly specified. After the transport, how the waste have to be unloaded and how the waste have to be again treated before it is disposed of safely from the environment. For example, biodegradable waste means it has to go for the composting. Composting, for the composting, if they use the earthworm, means they have to prepare the suitable bed, that is the bed. After that, they have to employ the earthworm, they put the earthworm, and after that, they have to treat this one in the form of the biodegradable form, and after that, you will get the compost. That compost can be used as a manure. Now, if you are used for the, as far as the non-biodegradable wastes are concerned, you have to develop an incineration plant. That incineration plant have to be specified at only those places only you can have an incineration plant. And the incineration plant specification is also mentioned, and how the incinerator have to be carried out also be mentioned, because if you maintain a low temperature, a little bit less temperature, means this incinerator will produce the dioxins, and these dioxins are considered the worst air pollutants and they are carcinogenic in nature. So, you have to be very, very careful in the incineration process. After that incineration, whatever that ash which has come at the bottom, this is considered as the bottom ash, and that bottom ash is considered as an hazardous waste. Again, the hazardous waste have to be collected, transported, and it has to be dumped at the safe site as per the hazardous waste management handling rules. Now, municipal solid waste management clearly states the biodegradable, non-biodegradable, source segregation, transportation of the waste, then dumping of the waste, treatment of the waste. It is very clearly specified in the municipal solid waste management handling rules. After that, you have got the public liability insurance rules. Public liability insurance rules is nothing but whatever that Public Liability Insurance Act says, that has been brought in the form of the rules for that matter. Then, of course, you have got the Forest Conservation Act. Under that, the Forest Conservation rules are also there. Now, we have seen a good amount of the legislations with reference to the Indian condition. Now, I told you in the beginning itself, environment should not be viewed in an isolated way. Environment have to be viewed in a holistic way. Environment must be viewed in a comprehensive way. It has to be viewed in the international way, and it has to be seen at the global way. And even a proverb says, you have to see the environment globally, act locally. Think globally and act locally. In that case, even though India is a socialistic, sovereign, socialistic, secular, democratic country, the sovereignty, this is our land. We can use our land for anything and everything for that matter. That is what the sovereignty gives the right. But as far as the environment is concerned, we have entered several agreements in the international scenario, that international conventions, international protocols, international covenants, thereby we are giving certain promises how we have to use our land for that. Why I am stressing this point here means, just because we are the owner of this land, just because we are enjoying the sovereignty of that land, we cannot use it for anything and everything. We cannot burn the carbon related matter, anything, and thereby causing the pollution. Whatever the pollution which you are doing it, or whatever the carbon dioxide which you are generating it, that may not be effect, that may have effect not only over our land, but it will also have an effect on the other land also, for that matter. So, in that case, there are several global conventions which are restricting how your environment, your homeland have to be used, how it should not be used for that. Now, in that way, at the global level, at the international level, what are all the various declarations, what are all the various conventions, what are all the various agreements, what are all the various covenants which have been signed by India, let us have a comprehensive and a broad picture for that. The first one, international environmental law, I will see the essential elements. Under the United Nations Charter, Article 2, Subsection 7, that is, nothing contained in the present charter shall authorize the United Nations to intervene in matter which are essentially within the domestic jurisdiction of the state. So, this clearly gives the right, that is, to the state to enjoy their land for that matter. Or the sovereignty is being once again reinforced by the United Nations. Now, declaration of the permanent sovereignty over the natural resources, again under the UN General Act 1803, 1962, Article 1, the rights of the people and the nation's permanent sovereignty over the natural wealth is very, very clearly given. No country can interfere in exploring or exploiting our own natural wealth. Of course, that is using of our natural wealth also for that. This was the existing scenario. But the very same thing, in the due course of the time, various other environmental declarations, covenants are putting certain restrictions over this sovereignty for that. It may not be the directly, but it has got an indirect effect for that matter. Now, to conclude this session, we have discussed the various acts with reference to environment and the various rules brought under the Environmental Protection Act. Now, I would like to put the following questions. First one, discuss the various environmental related acts enacted by our parliament. The second one, explain the various rules brought under the Environmental Protection Act.
Thank you.
Thank you.